Well, good evening, everyone. This is another in the series of the Fireside Chat, which I started a while back. Tonight, we are incredibly fortunate to have a wonderful truther by the name of Nicholson 1968, who comes all the way from the southern United States, and he joins us tonight by the fireside. Hello, Nicholson.
Hello. Yeah, I brought the I'm glad I brought my marshmallows so we can kind of roast them by the fire. That's what we do in the South. So I'm honored to be here tonight. That should
Roasting chestnuts, especially this time of year.
Yep, chestnuts by the fire.
And it's just incredible because there's been a few people that have said we need to come together and compare notes because we're kind of on the same page. And actually, this is the first time we've talked together properly.
Yeah, it's true, and it is funny. I get a lot of comments, a lot of emails. They said you guys need to come together, exchange notes, whatever it is. But you know what the real truth is? They just want to hear the two accents together. That's what it really is. So,
Well, you were showing me your impression of the English accent. Do you want to give it a spin?
yes, this is Nicholson 1968 coming from Southern America. Let me tell you.
Honestly, why do so many Americans, when they do it, they do this kind of like this? And it's like, I don't know. I didn't know I spoke like
I don't know. I mean, I like your voice.
that, but.
I do not like my voice. See, that's a little bit of, for people listening, they're like, why can't we see you, Nicholson? Or why don't you speak on your videos? And that's part of it is, number one, I don't particularly like how I look or particularly like how I sound. I just want people to come and get the information and not judge. You know what I mean? Because some people may come there and say, okay, I don't like how he sounds, and they click off. Or I don't know, I don't like how he looks, and they click off. My way, you get to see the information and you don't judge. You just go, here's the info, it's right here for me, and then you go
Well,
from there.
you must be what, on the Bible Belt in the US?
A little bit southern of the Bible Belt. I'm like at the Bible knees, wherever you are. I'm from southern Florida, so let's put it that way.
Okay. So what's it look like over there at the moment in terms of all of these things happening?
For those asleep, there it's business as usual. If we can just vote the right people in, they're going about their day. For people like us that are awake, you see a little on a different level. It's business as usual over here. They just think, okay, when we get Obama out and we get somebody else in, they're going to fix it. And that kind of mentality of things are going to get better and things are going to get better, that kind of
Yeah.
mentality. Yep.
Yeah,
So.
I think it's pretty much the same mentality, it seems, across the whole world.
I think.
Certainly in the UK, it's as you say. But there is a disillusionment building, I notice, with politicians and politics. People are getting sick of the red and blue paradigm of the two, pillars that we're used to.
Yes, definitely.
Is that similar over there, or?
Similarly over here, I mean, there. I think of, let's just take the 9/11 thing. Look how many people have woke up to 9/11. I mean, it's taken them this long to figure it out. They all thought we were conspiracy nuts back in 2002 when we told them it was an inside job or whatever. But you have a lot more people that are awake now. And that's just like transhumanism. I was talking about transhumanism in 1998 and thought I was nuts. Now everybody on YouTube's talking about transhumanism, so.
And that's only in the last few years, because I remember I used to listen to Alex Jones and he was talking about it, and back then it kind of did seem a bit conspiratorial, just sort of 4 or 5 years ago. But now it's right in front of everyone's eyes.
It is, and there's a lot more people, I think, in the U.S. that are trying to wake up, are trying to look for the truth. It's a little more hard to find it because you're not going to find it on the media outlets and in your textbooks, you're having to go underground, you know, YouTube, websites, you know, things like that.
I mean, they don't overtly expose the agenda, but I suppose if you look in magazines, you can see everywhere that this technology is becoming ridiculously intrusive, like biometric data on iPhones now, and it is just absolutely taking over.
It's hard to function in today's society without it. And that's done on purpose. And people, I don't think they realize there are people part of a bigger agenda that don't know they're part of a bigger agenda. Everything, you know, I think a lot of people think that there's a bunch of men sitting around a table somewhere plotting and planning everything. And it's much deeper than that. It's on a more spiritual level. You either have the mind of Christ or you have the mind of something else. Mm-hmm. You're either moving, I believe, you're either moving one kingdom one way or you're moving the other kingdom the other way. That's it. There's no other, you know, that's part of my motto. There's one game, one end game. Everything else is smoke and mirrors. And you better figure out what the end game is. If you think it's about Democrats and Republicans, it's about the... You got to start looking deeper than what is the end game and what is your enemy after.
Yes. So in terms of the end game, obviously we know where this is headed. Do you think that the technology that's coming out now and the stages of it is a good indicator on how far towards the end game we actually are?
I think so. And what I'm about to say, a lot of people may disagree. I think a lot of people out here think Jesus is just around the corner, that it's right at the door. Me personally, I don't think we are. Technology has to increase. There's some things in prophecy that I'm seeing that there has to be a couple of events to happen. See, I mean, it's already being done now, but there's got to be an event that Christ is got to be a fairy tale. It's got to be a fairy tale. It has to really, really fade away of why he actually came. And technology has to increase even more so. And
yeah, which is part, I think that's partly why they're exposing, externalizing the Vatican and everything as part of that game of saying, you know, that Christ is lumped in with the deceptive religious church.
Right. I agree with you there. You know, it's, we're definitely in the, I believe, toward the end, you know, 90%, maybe. I mean, I don't know dates or times, but I mean, we're definitely knocking pretty close, but I just don't think it's going to be, next year or next week or whatever. I just think there's a lot of other pieces that have to be put into place.
And this of course ties into the rapture deception, which we're going to go into in a second, if that's all right. But I wanted to talk to you before that about this technology, because you do a lot of remarkable work on transhumanism and stuff like that. I mean, do you think this technology has come from the abyss?
Definitely. And let me get something clear. I've not really, maybe subscribers, viewers. I am not against, when I speak of technology as a bad thing, I speak of it as how far we take it. Like if someone loses a limb and they replace their limb or, you know, a pacemaker, that's not evil. That has nothing to do with what I'm coming from and what is in the prophecy that I see of the iron and the clay. So what I'm saying is a lot of people go, well, you know, you're just trying to, that's transhumanism is, you know, trying to help man excel or whatever. To a certain degree, it is, but when you take it so far of downloading your consciousness, into other vessels and other cloning. People that believe that it's just science fiction, no, we have the technology. It is being done. It is being done right under your noses, and you don't even know it. And if you don't, that goes back to what we're talking about. If you don't know the end game, then you won't believe cloning. You won't believe transhuman.
I mean, it confuses me why people can't see the absolute weirdness that, in the last 50 years, technology has accelerated at an incredible rate. I mean, so that they're trying to tell us that what we've come from the Stone Age and moved really slowly over thousands of years and barely even, you know, been able to function as in a advanced society, and then suddenly within 50 years we're like flying to the moon and mixing technology with our flesh.
Right, and you know, when you take scriptures like Satan is the kingdom of the air, prince of the air, what do you do with that scripture? I mean, I know what to do with that scripture. Go into a church and ask Prince of the Air. I mean, really, get an answer. Or come to my channel. I'll tell you exactly what that means. It's wireless. It's technology. It's, what do you do with those who lose their lives, gain it, and who that try to gain their life? I mean, who try to gain their life, lose it, and who lose their lives, gain it. Mm-hmm. I mean, unless you know what transhumanism is, you see the deeper meaning behind these scriptures that actually makes sense.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you this. See, this is what people need to understand. The elite are using the technology because they want to live forever that way. And they're also going to use the technology to keep the rest of the sheep, or whatever you want to say, as slaves. You can use the airwaves to control the masses, but they're going to use it. They want to use it a different way. And when their body wears out, they have a clone. They download their consciousness into the next vessel. And I know a lot of people are going, what? What is he talking about? I'm telling you, the technology is there. It is being done. That's why they cloned the first sheep. Notice, the first animal was a sheep, and they called it Dolly. Now, they're slapping Christ in the face. Number one, a sheep. Are followers of Christ, and they called it Dolly, like a little doll.
Because, of course, well, Christ offers us the real eternal life, whereas this is the Satan's counterfeit.
Right. Everything. Artificial intelligence. That's why it's called artificial.
Yeah. Of course, there's always the theory that if they need to transfigure the planet in whatever way that takes shape, that they would need this technology, or they would need to somehow do that in order to be in this transfigured world.
Exactly. The new age, or whatever you want to say, or raise the consciousness of everybody, or whatever. I mean, it's just, you know, notice it speaks in the Bible of the simplicity of Christ. He came as a man, and he died as a man. And when Peter jumped up and tried to stop him, when he was telling, I mean, think about this, Christ is sitting there telling him, I've got to die. Peter jumps up and says, no, I won't let him kill you. What does he say to him? He says, get behind me, Satan. So Christ calls Peter, he calls him Satan. Why? Mm. Because Peter is trying to save him and keep him in a physical form here in this world.
Yes, precisely. And the flesh is part of the beast.
That's right.
Kingdom and the material world. And this ties into the rapture. And I think the false rapture that's being pushed is part of that agenda of trying to make you save your flesh and be more concerned with Christ. Our real life is after death. It's not in saving our fleshly body.
I agree, and it makes a Christian lazy because you're relying on Jesus to do all the work and you don't have to do anything. I mean, to a certain degree. But, see, you know, when you talk about the rapture, man, it serves up a hornet's nest.
Yeah.
And I'm just here, I'm not here to tickle ears. I'm here to tell you the truth.
Yeah,
And I think you are too, and that's why, you know, when you start looking at scriptures, and you really start looking at the character of God and the character of, I mean, Noah had to build an ark. Joseph had to save up for 7 years of famine. Everybody in the Bible had to do something to be saved. You know what I'm saying? God didn't just come back and just take Noah. I mean, he took Enoch and he took, you know, but it's just not in his character. You've got to.
Yeah.
He's going to take care of you, but you got to do something. You got to listen. You've got to be seeking.
Yeah, you're not saying here that it's beyond grace as such, but you're saying in this life we will face tribulation, right, as Christ told us, and that is the way. He showed us the way, and we have to take up our cross and endure to the end.
Exactly, and you know you may not like that, but that's just. That's the way it is, and it is finished, you know, and he overcame death for you. All you got to do is follow him. That's part of it, you know.
Yeah, there's absolutely nothing to fear.
Right. You know, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. I mean, that's basically it, and that's hard in this world, I know. I mean, I've got family and, you know, things like that, and we all get scared or whatever, but you know, now that you learn more about what's really going on and why, you know, why it is about his blood and what he did, you know, and it gives me more comfort. You know, I'm not just sitting here telling you that because just to be telling you that.
Yeah, and this is the problem with being conformed to the pattern of this world, is that mm-hmm. it's going to lead you into the clutches of Satan. By following the trends, just look around you, the biometric data that's being taken, just the way that technology, this new technology is incredibly blinding people, causing them to be addicted to things that are blinding them, and just making them focus on the flesh and on themselves primarily.
Yeah,
like Facebook now, it's just it's just
the whole picture with taking selfies. I mean, right there, selfies. You know, you're taking the little screenshots of yourself and sending them out. You know, whatever. I'm not being righteous. I'm not being judgmental. It's just if you step back for a minute, it's just what you said. This system is making it. Making you be more selfish and all about you, not about the, you know, helping others and things like that. And look what technology has done. It can be a good thing, but let's be honest. An email, you know, I've had kids. One would be upstairs and one would be downstairs. They won't even talk to each other. They just text each other.
Yeah.
So the art of conversation is being lost.
Uh-huh.
Look, texting in itself has to do with getting man ready for the transhumanism. This is me. Is, you know, they say you're going to have one universal language. Well, what language do you think that's going to be? English? No. It's going to be computer code. That's what it's going to be, because you're going to be in a digital era, and you either get on board with this or you don't. You're going to be left behind.
Mm-hmm.
And people say, well, he won't be able to buy and sell. You start understanding now. See, a lot of people think the Bible has to do with a bunch of old men back in the day. And yes, it does. But also what I like about the Bible is it's really, really telling you some things about the future of digital currency, things that are way in the future that are amazing and scary at the same time, with the of where it's going with the technology.
Yeah, because I've even heard the one world currency could be called the Phoenix. So there you go.
Yeah, there you go.
But so essentially we are talking about technology that has come from the incredibly intelligent minds of the fallen. I think people misunderstand the intelligence of these beings. They severely underestimate what they are. I'm not saying we need to be scared of them, but I'm just saying that they are incredibly intelligent. And they know the human nature and how to play humanity.
They do. A lot of people, and maybe you'll agree with me, is, you know, what we're saying, or what I'm saying, is, look, Lady Gaga, Beyonce, and Jay-Z are not who we're talking about. We're talking about people behind the scenes, the ones that do the artwork for these CD covers. They're the ones who are right. Notice this. Back in the 60s, artists wrote their own music. Music artists rarely write their own music anymore. It's done by the corporations, the Sonys, the people behind the scenes. These are the ones we're talking about. The fallen minds, they're just the puppets out front doing the show. I mean, that's where it's coming from, and it's way advanced. It's way what we're dealing with. And, you know, people can pretend that it's not happening all they want. And, you know, I all I can do is put my videos out, do my website, and let the people come to it that need to see it, and leave it at that, you know.
So why do you think that they are showing us so much stuff in terms of, I mean, even that comes to mind, the black goo, as you've covered in your recent videos, why do you think they're showing? Do you think this is to do with energy, or do you think it's a spiritual rule that they need to expose these things, you know, externalize these things as it progresses, or?
A number of things. I think you'll agree with me. They're trying to get the world to embrace Luciferianism. Call it whatever you want, different names or whatever. It's basically at the core Luciferianism. Yeah. Albert Pike spoke about it. I think you agree with that.
Yeah.
That's number one. I think it is, believe it or not, you know, I've asked many times, God, why are you allowing certain things? Why did you allow, you know, what happened to Job in the story of Job? I mean, you know, but that's part of the testing, because if you're going through what you're going through, and you're still seeking the truth, and you're still seeking the right things or whatever, that's what the Creator wants to see. He does not want someone that just gives up and tries to do the easy way and sells out for money or whatever. You can't serve two masters. Call it what you want. He doesn't want a kingdom built with those types, I believe.
And that's so nice to hear you say that.
And, you know, my thing is, they're showing this stuff because here's the thing. Satan and the fallen are the accusers. Remember, you got to remember this. These, what they're doing, they're telling God, you're going to give the kingdom to these?
Mm-hmm.
Remember, this is what started the rebellion. They don't have a clue. This, I'm just paraphrasing. Look, Creator, God, whatever you want to call him, Yahweh, you know, we have different names or whatever, but basically, you want to give the kingdom to these humans, not to us. And they don't see you, they don't worship you. It's kind of like mocking them. See, look what we've done. We got this stuff right in front of them, and they can't even see it. There's like the mocking. That's one reason, I believe. And then the other is, I believe they have to show it, because you can't say you didn't see it. It was right put in front of you. It's like this. It's like a radio. Right now, there's radio waves all around us. Now, whether you tune into them or not, that's the different story. But there's stuff around you right now. There's information that you could be trying to learn the truth, whatever. But if you choose to turn on American Idol and Dances with the Stars every night, and you go out and do whatever, then that's on you. But the information is here. Even though there's some stuff hidden, because here's the thing. If you think I'm a prophet, or if you think I'm some special man, I'm not. All I did was pray and ask to help me understand the mark of the beast,
mm-hmm.
show me. I don't want to fall. I don't want my friends to fall. I don't want my family to fall. And that's how this thing started. It wasn't that God landed in my backyard and said, hey, Nicholson, start a website and I'll show you. That's not how it happened.
It seems a lot of us have been on this similar journey where we've kind of got to this point where we're like, look, I know nothing. Please, God, show me. And it's not being broken. It sometimes takes a little bit of breaking down of your ego, and that can be painful to go through. But essentially, it's really, really comforting to be in that place with God, to just finally admit that we are, you know, we need Him and we need to be humble.
Exactly, because at the end of the day, we're peons. What I mean by that is we're limited in our capacity to understand. He's got the plan. We may not understand. See, we're children, and children want to go out in the street and play. But the Father says, don't go out in the street and play right now. I know you want to. Mm-hmm. When you get a little older, you know.
It's dangerous out there.
It's dangerous. So, I mean, that's kind of the way it is with life is you're not going to understand all of it in the stage we're in. The next stage, I believe you will understand because remember Jesus said, I have things I want to tell you, but you can't bear it. There, even if He wanted to tell you, we wouldn't understand it in our development. Just like you were an embryo in your mother's womb, you were alive, you were an embryo, but you were in that stage of development, and you could only understand certain things at that level. Then you came to this level, you came into this physical form, and then when we go to the next level, you'll get more information. I truly believe that.
Like you say, we need to learn these things incrementally, almost, because like all of it at once would be far too much to handle. Some days I just discover things through what He shows me, and it's just little pieces at a time, little breadcrumbs at a time towards a bigger truth, and sometimes that is almost too much to handle, just the small parts that you learn.
Exactly. And you got the key to it is in order to get from A to D, you got to understand B and C.
Yeah.
And if you rush that process, that's where a lot of people turn off religion or Christianity, whatever you want to call it. You know, I have people make comments with, I don't want to worship a sacrificial God that wants sacrificial and demanded blood, and He's a mean God and whatever, and they just, you know, they just shut down because they're not taking it a piece at a time. To try to understand what's coming.
Yeah, like Paul's description of love, that to me is the Father, patient, kind, keeps no record of wrongs, and this is why He sent Christ. People need to understand it is not a Father trying to torture this man in Christ. It is literally His love, and He gave Himself in the greatest way the world has ever seen.
More than people really, I think, realize. You know, they just think it's all, you know, it's like a cliche. I hear it all the time. Oh, He came and died on the cross for us, and it's about the blood of Jesus Christ. Okay, but literally, you have to understand what I'm showing on my channel is you've got to do this thing His way. There's coming a time in the future for your kids, whenever that is, that you will try to live another way other than the way Christ showed us, period. Mm. And that was the other thing starting with my channel is I went looking for truth. You remember you said we started, hey, I don't know anything. I went, studied, you know, Allah, Buddha, New Age. I went looking for the truth. And I'll give you a little hint. Wherever the rulers of this earth and this world are attacking, there you'll find the truth.
Yeah.
It really is. So for me, I'm not pushing Christianity. I'm just telling you Right now, yeah, I'm pushing Christianity. You know why? Because the elite of this world that are ruling this world
are
trying
anti-Christian.
to, yeah, exactly. They're trying to keep you from Christ and that knowledge.
Yes. What would you say to people that, well, of course, we can see in movies everywhere that Christ is being mocked, just almost every movie. But what would you say to people who are like, well, this, the Bible, the New Testament is deception, it's been made up. If there really was a guy doing miracles, then they would, there'd be more external evidence. Do you think these evidences have been covered up by the Vatican? What's your take on that?
Oh, man. I'll tell you my take is the Bible is made up of 66 books for a reason. The 66 is very important, but those who follow me, there are other books that are inspired that are not included in it. People don't want to hear that, and that's fine, but I'm just telling you, if you don't want to read the book of Enoch, if you don't want to read the book of Jasher, the book of Jubilees and some of these things, that's on you. But people argue with me all the time. And here it is. I'm going to just lay it out. This holy book that I'm holding is true. These 66 books, everything in it is truth. So I take them to Timothy and Joshua where it says, isn't it written in the book of Jasher? Then they suddenly change. They go, well, no, the book of Jasher wasn't inspired. Wait a minute. The inspired book that you just said everything was true just told you, isn't it written in the book of Jasher?
Yeah, it's like it mentions the book of Enoch as well.
Right, mentions the book. Okay, so then what you got to do with that knowledge is read it, put it on the shelf. You can believe everything in it, whatever you want to do, but at least read it, and then there you go. Then the can of worms opens up, and this is what I do. I take the information, and I figure, okay, if it's left out, why is it left out? And very quickly, Enoch and Jasher speaks of DNA tampering, the fallen ones, the Nephilim, the things that were on the earth in those days and afterwards, spoken of Genesis 6:4.
Yeah, because I noticed the church don't teach about the Nephilim being hybrids.
Right. You see, here's the other thing that I've learned, is the masses are wrong, period. The masses are the one who kill Christ. And here's my example. Go into a church, and you go up on the stage, and you say, how many people here have heard of aliens? Every single person in that church has heard of aliens. Then ask them the next question. How many of you heard of Nephilim? Whoa, 5 people maybe? That should tell you something right there. If the masses believe in aliens and the minority believe in Nephilim, then who are you going to run with?
Yeah, I was always told they were deformed humans.
Right. So you got that. I got people talking about Christmas, And look, if a non-Christian is doing Christmas and a Christian is doing Christmas, then you need to ask yourself what's going on. Just things like that. I'm saying, you know what I'm saying? It's just,
Yeah, it's incredibly worldly from what I've seen, very materialistic these days.
Yeah,
But what I wanted to just touch before we leave the subject of the exterior gospels and that, like, what is your opinion? Because I personally think that some of the Gnostic, the Book of Mary and all these, like, do you think that they've been written a few hundred years after to kind of, I mean, they could have easily have taken from the texts, biblical texts that are available anyway, a few hundred years after Christ.
I do. I have to be very careful when the Book of Thomas, Book of Mary.
Yeah.
And I've read them, but then what I've done over the years, like I said, I've read them, and I always say this, I put it on a shelf in my mind. I put it in the shelf, and I pray about it. What's the Holy Spirit? Does this apply? Does it not? I'm not trying to pick or choose or anything like that. I'm just saying, at the end of the day now, where I'm at with what I've been shown, the end game, Enoch and the Book of Jasher are purposely taken out for a reason. They do not, the generations are, they do not want the masses to know about the Nephilim. They do not want the masses to know about the DNA tampering of animals and humans, things that were provoking the Lord. And that's where it goes into the days of Noah. If people think that God wiped out the earth because people were drinking and smoking and just having a little fun and partying or whatever, you're living in a dream world. There's a reason Noah was saved for his generations and his genes. That's why the first book of the Bible is Genesis, gene. Yeah. It has to do with genetics. It has to do with bloodlines of what is going on. That is it. The one game. There's a physical kingdom being built, and there is a spiritual kingdom being built. That is it. Mm-hmm. That is the only game in town. Everything else, you're fooling yourself.
Well, on the subject of Nephilim, I've asked other people this before. Do you think that we are literally, when these things, when the portals are broken open, whatever they're going to do you think that we're literally going to see the physical return of locusts, Nephilim, and things like that, like you see in Lord of the Rings, for example?
Here's my interpretation. Let's take the abomination that causes desolation in the holy place. And this is part of the deception too. I believe there is, I used to not, but the more things are shown, things that are coming out, I do believe that they will be shown, because notice also in Revelation, there will be things that men will see that will cause their heart to stop. I mean, that's literally in the Bible. So something is going to happen that's going to scare the living daylights out of mortal men.
Yeah.
And people don't want to hear that. They just think, okay, we're going to be taken out of the way, and we're going to be swept up in the clouds in the rapture. And see, you got to ask yourself, what's going to cause the falling away of the church?
Yeah.
And that part of it. Because here's the thing. When you've been told there's going to be a rapture and it doesn't happen and you're left here, then you're not, your faith in Christ, you're going to fall away because of what the angels of light told you.
Yeah, because one assumes is that they're going to oppose as light and pose as Christ. Christ says, if you hear of a Christ in the desert, do not go out there.
Right. So, you know, the one thing is when you're seeking for truth, you've got to be real with yourself. You've got to quit lying to yourself. You've got to sometimes, a lot of the times, go against the masses and your foundation breaks up. And that's not easy. And you know what I'm talking about. You were talking before we got on about being broken multiple times. And because your world is shaken up because you're seeing that you're being shown the truth. And it goes against the masses of this world. And that is hard for people because they don't like that. That's not a safe area. Believe me, what I do is not a safe place, as far as I can't just go out and talk to just anybody and have a conversation about what we're talking about. Very few people know what I believe. My family does, my immediate family, but just to go have a conversation at the local Walmart or down there, or go into a church and talk about what I'm talking about, it's not going to be received, because that's just the way it is. Only a few are going to embrace it, and only God knows who those few people are.
Yeah, I mean, it takes nothing to join the crowd, but it takes everything to stand alone. And what would you say to people sitting at home right now? What can they do if they're not into videos? What can they do? Is there ways they can reach out to their local community?
You mean to get the word out, or
just to raise awareness of the times we're in, or the emergence of the Antichrist. And I know these things are, to the public, are quite just not talked about at all, and you'd be seen as weird. But is there a way to gently inform people?
You may not like this answer, but I think the only thing that if you're not into videos or whatever, I think you pray about it. And here's the thing, don't take this the wrong way, is Nicholson 1968 ain't the savior. RSE isn't the savior. God's big enough to handle it. You do pray about it. Whatever God wants you to do, he'll move into your life. This is my example, is when I first got this knowledge, my mistake was going to run and tell everybody.
Yeah.
And guess what? I don't know people's hearts. Only God does. Mm-hmm. He's the only one who knows who's going to receive it.
So you're saying you felt the burden of responsibility.
Yeah, and what happened in the beginning is I was telling people, and it was turning them off against God to a certain degree. So what transpired for me, I can only speak for me, is I prayed about, okay, God, you're giving me this knowledge. What do you want to do with it? Because I'm getting beat up. I'm trying to tell people on the street, tell people in the churches. And then this is when the video started. Because, see, here's the thing that happens. I made videos. Then I have a website. I don't go talk to anybody. God leads them either to the website or to the videos that need to see it. Yeah, I get some people on there that don't get it or whatever, and that's okay. But see, I don't get bombarded anymore. I don't get beat up so bad. I just do what he showed me, and he leads the people to... So
have you noticed any increase in spiritual attack in your life since you stepped out and really tried?
I ought to put my wife on for that one. Without a doubt, I'm telling you, there's things that happen to me that would blow you away. Just, are you kidding me? I mean, financially, jobs, it's unbelievable. And yeah. I'm not just, it really, really is. I've come to the point sometimes where I'm like, you know, I'm taking this down. I'm taking Nicholson 1968 down. I'm taking the website down. But you know what? I can't do it because God's showing me stuff, and I've got to stick to that. Because I'll tell you this, if I go tomorrow, I did what I was supposed to do. And it'll be up. And at least people will say, Nicholson 1968, I might not agree with everything the guy did and the way he did it. Because a lot of people don't get into the music and all that. They want some church pew. I'm all for that, the church view. But I did what I was shown, and there's a lot of truth. And I feel good now. I have to tell you this. Now, the spiritual attacks have picked up. But I will tell you this, with my subscribers and my followers, they've come, a lot of them have gone, you know what? I remember when I first watched your videos 3 or 4 years ago, and I kind of thought you were a little nuts. But now, see, they've taken the time to educate themselves and pray, seek other truth, and the symbolisms that are coming out now, like you said, in movies, and it's all over the place. Now they'll watch my videos and they appreciate them. They're like, oh, man, now I see what you're seeing.
Yeah, like you were saying earlier, it's gone beyond just talking about the symbology itself, because that's very evident. Now we need to, the truth movement is moving into a much deeper stage of the real depth behind how all of this links together and proves Christ and shows that they're trying to open portals.
Exactly. And what they're trying to do of attacking the temple of God.
Yeah.
And we spoke about this. I'm going to put another marshmallow on the fire as we're sitting here talking.
But, it's nice, isn't it? It's quite warm.
Yeah, it is. But, you know, I see, I'm picking my words here very carefully. I see a lot of channels now pointing out pyramids and checkerboard floors and the all-seeing eyes and all that stuff. We're beyond that, guys. You've got to start seeing what are the messages being shown. Mm-hmm. Why? What are for the masses and what are not? Like the Beyonce thing, she flashed the Illuminati eye at the Super Bowl. Big deal. That is for the masses, people.
Jim Carrey.
Yeah, whoopee-doo, okay? Let's get to the Madonna Illuminati song. I've already seen it. There's already videos. Oh, man, have you heard the Illuminati song or whatever? Yeah, click. I got some stuff coming out that's showing you the truth behind stuff like that. What are they? It's distraction. You've got to move to the next level. Because
yeah, I've noticed. Just the amount of people that are becoming aware of the Illuminati, even sort of 15-year-olds, I see round about here.
Yeah, and don't think for a minute. See, that's the thing, is they see the masses, not the masses, but a lot more people waking up to the symbolism, so they have to get to, they're trying to go to the next level too with what they're doing. The hidden agenda. You know what I mean? I mean, that's the way deception works. Mm. And that's what people can't understand. Is if you think the devil's going to walk up to you with a pitchfork and a 666 and stamp it on your head, you're living in a dream world. And if you think the RFID chip is the mark of the beast, you're living in a dream world.
Yeah, people are going to want this.
Yeah, exactly. Satan is the seducer. He makes you fall with something that you want.
Yeah, yeah.
Never allowed to force anything. I mean, that's just not in his nature. I mean, that's not what God's allowing to happen. Because here's the thing. If Satan could have forced it, we'd all be dead by now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've often thought that, yeah. And that's the thing. Like, with this technology, it's going to probably offer people maybe healing from cancer and answers to... Maybe that's why they're pushing cancer. Look at the cancer rates that are increasing and all this kind of stuff, that people are going to... They're going to squeeze people in every way possible to want some kind of escape.
I believe, and I think an alien... Some type of alien fake invasion... that this is where they have the technology to save us all, we're hybrids created by the aliens.
Yeah,
the whole Christ thing is just a fairy tale.
Mm-hmm.
See, that type of event, you know, Project Bluebeam, whether people believe it or not or whatever, there is another step in their agenda. Just like 9/11 was a step in their agenda to bring in certain things.
So what are you seeing? Are you seeing literal returns of UFOs, or are you seeing kind of blue beam used in this as well? Or
I see blue beam, holographic, and then, you know, people need to understand, this is just me. Look, there are no aliens. It is Nephilim. It's fallen angels, whatever you want to say. But, you know, this is where the deception is going, and you're being set up. I mean, look at all of the movies, all of the alien movies, every single thing.
Yeah, just look at the picture Crowley drew.
Exactly. You know, so...
It was an alien with a massive head.
Exactly.
And these things emerged after the Nazi... In the media, these UFO propaganda came about after Hitler.
Hitler and all of that stuff, yeah. You know, so, you know, I kind of look at things of, I'm kind of like a chess player. I've been playing chess since I was about 5. My grandfather showed me. But, you know, this is a good example of the church. See, Nicholson 1968, you've got to understand in a good game of chess the offensive, but you've got to also understand the defensive moves. The church... They're stuck on the offensive. Well, we don't really need to hear the devil's plan or anything. We've got Jesus, and he's just going to rapture us away.
Mm-hmm.
Wrong answer, because you've got the art of war, especially spiritual war. You've got to know your enemy. You've got to know, and the church. Well,
Yeah, it's in a dire state, the church.
Yeah. The church is stuck in that all we need to do is know our moves. We don't have to know. Okay, well, I'm just saying, you don't, because the art of deception is, look, if Eve knew Satan's next move, she wouldn't have done what she did, period.
And this is why Jesus said, be wise as a serpent.
That's right. And people, traditional Christianity, they're stuck in this little dream world. And I say that over and over. You're living in a dream world. You've got to wake up of what is reality.
Yeah. I was told recently, Nicholson, to give up the ministry by some people at the church. So.
Why? Did they tell you why?
Because you shouldn't be touching on the occult for a start. That's dangerous. You shouldn't go anywhere near it. You shouldn't. But we're exposing it. We're literally showing the satanic nakedness of its stupid plan, which is clearly naked when you shine the light on it.
Right.
But we're not delving it. We're not practicing the occult. We're not using the occult.
Exactly.
But
that's whether this is where the fear comes in. I've heard people, I don't want to read the Book of Enoch because you don't need to be dealing in that. It opens a doorway.
Yeah.
I mean, just stuff like that. Okay, fine. Don't find out what the truth is, because for me, see, this is the way I believe too. Notice when Daniel was writing down certain things, and he said, you know, I don't understand what I'm writing down, Lord. And he said to him, you know, it's not for you to understand. When knowledge increases, it'll be for them. You just go write this down and go on your way and rest, Daniel. Okay. So here's the thing. What I'm being shown, what you are being shown, and other YouTubers, is there's a lot of things we're being shown right now that I didn't understand, but it might not be for this generation. Let me tell you, what I'm being shown of the transhuman, the black programmable matter that is so deep that people just think it's science fiction, and it's not. It may not be for my generation. It may be for my children or whatever. But, you know, there's things that are, you know, if we know it all, how does knowledge increase?
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. That's all I was saying. Yeah. Knowledge is always increasing. I don't know it all. RSE doesn't know it all. Every day I'm learning something. Whatever it may be, a little pieces of the puzzle.
Yeah, but of course, knowledge in a Gnostic way doesn't save us, as I'm sure you agree.
I agree.
Because knowledge will pass away, as the Bible says. Everything, prophecy will pass away. So what, in terms of why we need the blood of Christ, for someone who's listening who hasn't really considered these things, why would you say that we need the blood of Christ? Does that have a significance spiritually after death?
I believe it's a deeper meaning. What I mean, when you're asking me the blood of Christ, why the blood of Christ? And here's exactly, I think, what it means. Notice in Ephesians, when he speaks of he came here to break down the enmity between the two. We're tainted. And call it whatever you want. We got sin, whatever you want to say, is I don't know how to say this. There's something that he had to show us to get out of here. The only way out of this thing is to leave this physical realm. And no other prophet that I know of, or any other whatever you want to say, Allah, whatever, there. See, Jesus is showing you the truth of how, that's why they call him the truth, the way to what? The way to eternal life, and that is you've got to come as a man, and you have to die as a man, for things to be corrected of what Adam and Eve messed up. See, Adam and Eve messed up, and Christ had to come and show us the way to correct it. And that's why when he died, right before, not died, but when he gave up his spirit in the physical form, he said, it is finished. Mm-hmm. What's finished? It is finished. I just showed you how to overcome death. You have to die. You have to come and you have to die as a physical man. Everybody is appointed a time to, I mean.
Yeah, so, of course. And the main part of that, from what I've seen, is that he had to take on the curse of what this is. And the only way out for us is to rely on the way he made straight out of this loop.
And it is a loop.
Yeah.
And it is a curse. It is, you know, whether people want to believe that or not, we're tainted. We've got a mix, whatever you know, people can say, you know, it's sin or whatever, but it is.
Yeah, we're all marked essentially by the beast as part of the flesh. And we are tainted, and there is enmity, there is a veil, there is, and Christ is the way back to the Father because he did it the right way and made it straight. Do you think, what's your opinion on whether someone would, how would they accept Christ? Would they call on him to be their Savior, like the church says?
Yes. Just believe in him. Notice he says, believe on me.
Mm-hmm. Be born again out of the flesh.
Right. You know, believe on me, what I've done. And that's what you've got to believe. Because if you don't believe who he is, that notice it says about discerning spirits. Those who don't believe that he came in the flesh, don't trust him. Mm-hmm. They don't trust him. But believe in what he was about and why he did what he had to do.
Yeah.
You know, God just didn't just send him down here just to die, you know, and torture him, whatever. No, he just, he's showing you something. Mm-hmm. You've got to, so here's the thing. You have to follow him. You have to repeat what he's doing. So you come, pick, like you said, you pick up your cross, you go through these trials, tribulations, mm-hmm. and then you die.
And renew your mind.
Renew your mind and those kind of things. It sounds hokey sometimes, I guess, to some. But if you look at the deeper meanings of things like you're showing and I'm showing up to escape the loop, to get out of this physical form, that the flesh, whatever, that we're trapped in, you've got to do it his way. And I think some of the things I've been showing are a little bit more of the future of the transhumanism thing of the elite don't want to answer. They do not want, think about this, the elite don't want to answer to Christ. They don't want to bow to Christ.
Yeah.
The only way into the kingdom is spirit and water, not flesh and blood. Remember, you know this, flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
So if you stay here in a physical form, then you never go to the next level.
So do you think when you're born again, in some way, maybe even genetically or whatever, certainly spiritually, you are changed into a child of God, of the Father?
Well, that's a touchy subject. That I have deeper meanings to the born again thing.
Right. You
know, as he spoke to Nicodemus.
I do believe,
and it's twofold. I do believe, number one, when you ask that you believe in Christ, that he's your Savior.
Yeah.
That he helps you renew your mind and that you're born again spiritually. But I also believe that, remember what? We're tainted. You have to be born again. You have to die and then be born again.
So of a new seed.
A new seed. A new. It's like a caterpillar. The caterpillar starts off as an egg. We start off as an embryo. Then you come in, you're born, you come into the world, and the caterpillar is ugly. Just like a human form, we're ugly, sinners, whatever, and you walk through life as an ugly caterpillar. But the deception and what Satan is doing is, and the elite, he's lying to the elite. See, See, here's the thing with the elite. The elite think they're winning. No, they're not. They're just being lied to Satan just as much as anybody, if not more, because they're so arrogant. They think they have the answer. So back to the butterfly is the caterpillar is going to become a butterfly whether he knows it or not. If you just let it run its cycle of where God is going and letting it creation run its course, it will take care of itself. But what the elite are trying to do, they're trying to build a better caterpillar or build a better man, a better transhuman. See?
Mm.
You see what I'm saying? So, mm-hmm. Look, man, come as a man, die as a man, or you come as a caterpillar, then you go to the next stage. What's the next stage? You death, cocoon, hibernation, whatever you want to say.
Mm.
Then you become the butterfly. You get your wings, goes to the next level. But if the caterpillar is constantly trying to make itself a better caterpillar, it never becomes what it's supposed to become.
Yeah.
That's where transhuman comes in. You're trying to build a better man. We're not meant to be a better man. God, you have to have faith and trust in what we've been shown. That's where the prophecy comes of the Church of Philadelphia, Revelation 3:7.
Really, we are walking through the valley of the shadow of death at the moment.
Right.
And this is the deception. You do not want to choose this world, this life, because right. You need to lose your life in order to find it. The seed needs to be planted dead before it springs to real life.
Exactly. And that's why the deeper, the key of David, Revelation 3:7. Those who hold it true toward the end, the Church of Philadelphian age, there's only a remnant, the key of David, and it is very important. He that shuts it can't open it, and who opens it can't shut it. It's talking about a doorway here, people, and that it's very important, the key of David. And why? Notice this. Freemasons, Illuminati, Luciferians, they follow Solomon. Why do they follow Solomon? Because the kingdom goes to David, clearly. Why? Notice the two, the symbolism of David and Solomon. David is the man after God's own heart. David knows where God dwells. David gets the kingdom. Why not Solomon? Solomon was the wisest man on earth. Solomon was the richest man on earth. Why doesn't he get the kingdom? Because he was too busy building physical temples to other gods. The symbolism of David and Solomon. David is spiritual. Solomon is physical. The Illuminati, Freemasons, are the builders
mm-hmm.
who rejected
and they, the kingdom. Yeah, they revere yep. Solomon like some kind of Christ figure.
Exactly. And it's all about the physical versus the spiritual. And that's why it's called the Key of David. The Key of David is this. The only way into the kingdom is spirit and water, not physical, flesh and blood. That's why David gets the kingdom. He knows the secret. That's why notice that David killed a Nephilim. David killed a giant. And the seed of David is Jesus Christ, and he will return, guess what, to kill the Nephilim giants again. Look at the symbolism. It's the same thing being repeated.
Yeah, this is the thing. The spiritual allegories of the Old Testament are incredible. And I certainly think I see the Antichrist fitting the bill. It seems that the Antichrist has to follow these things as well, because this is obviously the Jewish belief that that's the Messiah that's to come, that's the false one. And right. It seems to follow the same, like in the movies, I see them riding on a donkey. I see pushing down the pillar, all of this kind of Samson, all of it is what our Christ did and what the false one will do a counterfeit of.
Yeah. I think a lot of it's going to be for show. The masses are waiting for some physical guy to walk into a holy place, put something in it that causes abomination, it causes desolation, in a holy place. They're looking for somebody to come in, declare himself to be God, and put something in the temple that causes desolation. And they're looking at a physical temple. And that's not it. What it's pertaining to is what you were talking about earlier, answering the Nephilim thing. Notice about when the church goes into the wilderness, it said, and when you see the abomination put in the holy place that causes desolation, you are to flee. You're flee to the mountains. Now notice, what about the rapture? See, well, then why did God tell you to flee into the wilderness after the abomination? You see, that's where the whole rapture thing, I don't understand where people are talking about it. It's plain and simple. Is this goes back to the DNA tampering things I'm showing, like my project, Illuminati Black Project, Black Gold. Things are tampering with that they're trying to put in the temple of God. And if you do not understand where the temple of God is, you're lost. Man, we are the temple of God. And when something is trying to be put into us that causes desolation where God cannot dwell anymore, mm-hmm. and that has to do with the transhuman thing. And when you start to see that happening, that's when you are to flee into the wilderness, into the mountains, because... See, Satan will control the masses with the airwaves. So those who take the mark of the beast, which is this DNA tampering programmable matter that people think don't exist, which come to my channel, I've got scientific research, MIT's doing it. And if you'll allow me, I will tell you this. About the mark of the beast. Notice every verse it says it has to be counted. It has to be calculated. Every single verse that has to do with the mark of the beast, it says it has to be calculated and it has to be counted. So that means it can't be just 666. It has to be figured out. And that's it.
That's very interesting.
It's very interesting. And here's the thing. If you want to go deeper into a scientific transhumanism of, well, you say the mark of the beast is transhumanism. What does that have to do with 666? And here's what I know you understand what I'm saying, but you have to understand how the elite think and how they do math and how they do and they communicate, because it's like the Tower of Babel. They tried to do certain things before. But then God confounded their language where they couldn't communicate. What has happened is they don't use normal language anymore. They use symbols. They use numbers, backwards, whatever. It doesn't matter. That's how they're communicating. And that's what I've been allowed to see to a certain degree. And I'm going to ask the audience now, and I'll show you what I mean. I'm going to ask you a question. The same way, there's two correct answers. I want you to take 66 and add a 6. Okay? Now, I'm asking you, RSE, I want you to take 66, add a 6. What is the answer?
72.
Okay, 72. That's the way Satan teaches math. 66, add a 6, 72. Now, let me tell you how the elite... ask it the same way. 66 add a 6, 666.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. 66 add a 6.
It's, with all these things, it's always right, so simple and plain right in front of you. And that's, I think people think sometimes too deeply and just overlook things, and it's right there.
It's right there. So to the elite, 66 is 6 times 6, 36, 3 sixes.
But do you see that there is actually truth? This is the way it always works. There's actually truth in that, but it's a deceptive truth.
Exactly. It's just a matter of which way you look at it. If you ask little Johnny who discovered America, he's going to say Christopher Columbus. But if you ask the American Indian who discovered America, he's going to say, nobody discovered me. I've always been here. See, it just depends on who you're asking and where you're standing at the time you ask that question.
Yeah, there's a lot of terms for these things, like doublespeak we've heard of. There's obscuritanism. But another one is called Aesopian language, which is communications that convey an innocent meaning to outsiders but hold a concealed meaning to informed members of a conspiracy.
Right.
So Aesopian language.
Yeah, and so, it's like Freemason. Yeah. On the outside, a Mason is a physical builder. But on the inside, information of a builder is what we're talking about. Yeah. Esoteric and esoteric, whatever, you know what I'm saying. So once people understand that there's deeper meanings, you know, to a lot of these things they do, you know, then you can move forward. But if you just, you know, you talk to Freemasons, hey, I'm a third degree Mason and it isn't satanic. Okay, whatever. I'm just, you know.
And do you know why they wear the skins?
What do you mean?
The aprons.
I think they...
To do with Genesis.
I've heard also that they put their deeds in that. So when they present them, they put their little deeds in the aprons, because the Babylonians have aprons, Egyptians have aprons, Mormons have aprons. Mm-hmm. It's about the deeds. But what have you heard?
I've just heard about the skin covering in Genesis that in some, so I think it's the King James Version, calls it aprons anyway. Or something like that, but yeah, just to do with the covering when they realize their nakedness in the garden. But we're gonna just move on quickly, just to the final just the final point before we finish, because we've been going probably nearly 2 hours now.
Okay.
Yeah, the energy harvesting. I wanted to talk to you briefly about the energy harvesting. There's a lot of it going on.
I'm not too familiar with that. So,
well, just like in terms of rituals, obviously it's about the energy collection for their agenda.
Okay.
Yeah.
When I started till this point, you're right. I mean the energy and the way they're getting more blatant out in the open with I mean, I want to ask you a question. Do you believe that it really, truly gives them energy? Or is it, you know, they're doing the rituals and the things they're doing. Do you think it gives them energy? Or is it just a, what do you think?
Well, it was recorded when 9/11 happened. There was a surge in energy across the globe because of the negative energy that came from the mass mourning. So I guess some of these big events like that have a big purpose in terms of, well, cracking open net collection of negative neutrinos, cracking open portals. But even like with the music festivals, you've got mass energy and the Olympics ceremonies and all those kind of things. And they're massive events to them.
I guess, and in the mind, I have to agree. Unfortunately, I have to agree that, you know, that's why I don't watch much TV or news anymore, because it really, and you'll probably agree with this, is I have to limit making videos sometimes and what I watch or whatever, because you can get, you know, the negative energy of just too much of it. You've got to have some positive and, you know, spend a little time with Christ and read the positive. You know, it gets a little hectic. I've seen out there on YouTubers, KJ, scariest movie ever.
Yeah.
He'll agree. I mean, you've got to pull away from it for a little while.
Yeah, it's sad. Sad that he's finished that show, but it's good. So, but yeah, it's just like you say. But the newspapers, the news, the mainstream news, it's always so much negative energy, and
do you see that a lot over there in England? I mean, do you see the news
Yeah, I've stopped watching the news because it's just ridiculous. Like, I go into the shop now, I just kind of feel like a foreigner anyway, but you just catch the headlines and it's like, it's either something about celebrity Big Brother or just some really negative, evil ISIS, we're all going to die propaganda.
Yeah. Something I was going to ask you that, I mean, you know, do you think... Do you think we're close, or do you think it's a little ways off too?
I think personally, and obviously I'd never predict anything, and I wouldn't want anyone to think that it's necessarily the case, but personally, I think towards 2020, 2016, 2017, 2018, very interesting years. Certainly the things that are the events that are happening in those years. We've got the Super Bowl next year, the CERN turning on around the same time, Phoenix, Arizona. You've got 2016 Tomorrowland, Brazil, the Olympics, Obama's supposed to be stepping down. 2017, interesting signs in the stars. I don't,
Yep.
it's just so much. And
Yeah.
I don't mean that in an astrological prediction way. I mean in terms of signs in Revelation that are coming to pass.
Right. I've often wondered, on a side note, like, God, what are you waiting on? What's there's so many souls that have to be won, or whatever it is, but it seems to be more as I go along is the more, like in the days of Noah, the more we get mankind is tampered with and more negative energy, and there's like less and less of, you know what I'm saying? That's when it's gonna hit the fan, so.
Yeah, certainly. And I think the time we're in now, on a positive note, I think the time we're in now is going to see a revival of sorts. I think there's going to be a spiritual revival for Christ, for the Father, before these things, because as the truth is revealed, as they externalize the Luciferian symbology and everything, you start to also get the match of that, which is the Father's truth, the only truth, that will
Yep.
come out as a result, because how can't it? Because it is the truth.
Right.
You see what I
I agree.
mean?
Oh yeah, definitely.
So I think that we'll see a revival.
I think we're on the same page of a lot of things. I can't say that for all YouTubers, but that are out there. But I do have to agree. We do have a lot in common in our videos, and I think some of the things that we've been shown and. So we'll see, but I think you're right. It's going to be, I never did a video of 2012 was the end of the world, so
No,
I remember everybody was doing that, and it was just a laugh. Like, I never.
no. I tell you what, it is comforting to be on a similar page to you, because sometimes you do think, "Am I absolutely crazy?" Because most people around you make you think you are. So it's
Yeah.
nice to speak to someone who.
Well, I have some stuff that in my bag of tricks, not bag of tricks per se, but I had some stuff that I don't know how to put it in a video because it's so different. I don't think it's the right time because just like when I first started, the whole transhumanism thing, it has to come about, you know what I'm saying? And now it's being well received, whereas before. So I still have some information on my shelf
Yeah,
that
as you do, and just it comes about when it needs to, the
needs
way I've
to.
seen it. Yeah,
So.
and I just keep up the work, man. And we're gonna end the show there probably, but just keep up the work. You are doing such a good job. Honestly, your videos are so deep. Some of them when I first came across them, I was like, wow, this is incredible. And I really think that God is showing you some very interesting things.
Well, I appreciate that, and I do. It was enjoyable to talk with you, and because you're right, sometimes you're like think people think you're crazy, but if other people are seeing it and it's being shown to others, that's the one thing that's been good for me with the website and YouTube and Vimeo is, hey, there's other people who are seeing what I'm seeing, so it makes me feel. I appreciate that.
I definitely think we're in the season, and perhaps we are close. So we'll keep going. I can't ever see me giving up this target. So I don't know about you, but
I'll support you. You just let me know when you get the radio show. Supposedly you're working on that. Whenever you announce that, I'll put it on my website to link it
Yeah,
to
as I
Nicholas.
said, yeah, I'd love to have
1960.
you as a guest.
Yeah, so
Yeah,
yeah,
so
I'll
what's your website?
Nicholson1968.com.
There you go. Go and check out, people. As Nicholson said, the RSE Radio will be starting in the new year at some point, and I will most definitely have you on as a guest.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. It's been a great time in front of the fire.
Yeah, I got to get a couple of more marshmallows, and then I'll be out of here.
I'm going to throw some water on it.
Yep, that's right. Well, throw, yeah. I'll put a little marshmallow on the fire, mate.